Please join me in welcoming John Wallace.
Thank you, Charlie, both for inviting me and for the introduction, and Kathy for all the arrangements. As Charlie said, this is in some ways a continuation of the work that I did with Doug North and Barry Weingast in our book Violence and Social Orders. And for a long time, Doug was a co-author. Doug will be 94 on November 5th, and so he doesn't write very much anymore. But we argue. So I write, we argue. And at one, he finally said, I don't want to be a co-author. I'll do something. So I'm not going to blame Doug for anything, but this has kind of been a joint project for the last 5 years. I have too many slides, so I'll try to get through them all in my allotted time. The really central problem of the social sciences is not just economics, it's how societies are coordinated, right? How societies work, how people interact with one another. Economics over the last several hundred years has really made a contribution to understanding how independent decision making can be coordinated through markets and prices. And we know those markets work best in developing countries and have promoted lots of economic growth and lots of economic development, but also political development, civil rights, political rights. Markets by themselves do not appear to be the magic wand, that they're by themselves are insufficient to guarantee coordination. So that when we go to a developing country, we say, you need markets. And so we say, here's the institutions you need. We give them to them, and bing, 20 years later, we come back and they're gone, or they haven't worked. Because we don't really understand the dynamics that sustain particular kinds of social institutions, including markets, but also governments and churches and schools and things like that. So developed societies over the last 200 years have figured out a way to limit violence and coercion, that they're much smaller threats in our daily lives. And when that's the case, markets work a whole lot better. It's not a function of the markets per se, it's a function of the fact that people are not so worried about who they're dealing with. Governments in those societies that are able to limit violence, and they have rules about limiting the use of violence and that they're able to enforce. But some of the rules, not all the rules, but some of the rules in developed societies have a very unusual feature. They treat everybody the same. That is, their impersonal rules. Now, many of you probably watched O.J. Simpson drive around 20 years ago. And think, well, wait a minute, he got off. You know, how did the rules in America treat everybody the same? And of course, in some absolute sense, no, you know, because there are no perfectly impersonal rules. But, you know, if you want to get a driver's license in the United States, you pass the test, you get a driver's license. Okay? It isn't who you know or what you know, it's what you do. The rules apply equally. And there's a wide range of rules in developed societies that are actually created and enforced impersonally. And that really changes the dynamics of how the society works, because you're not crafting a rule for one group that applies differently to that group than other groups. We might call rent-seeking or interest groups or things like that. You're creating a rule that, in some sense, the process has to agree on that applies equally to everybody. So we really want to understand where impersonal rules come from. Economists often say that developed societies have more secure, they have rule of law and secure property rights, and we really don't understand where that comes from. I mean, we understand how to describe it, and we can talk about Britain, and we talk about the United States, and we can trace out the events that have occurred. But we really don't know how to make it happen in another society, as evidenced by our failure to make it happen after the expenditure of billions of dollars. So coercion is the threat of violence. All societies have to come to some arrangements that limit the use of violence. Markets and prices are much less effective at allocating goods and services in a world where violence really matters. And the reason is, in a society where violence is a potential, you have to know who you are dealing with. Either you have to know them personally, sometimes knowing them personally means you don't want to deal with them because they're potentially violent, or you have to know what organization they belong to. One can call this ethnic groups, tribes, patronage networks, religions. Right, we didn't have to do anything but pick up the paper to know that those identities really matter, and that for a large percentage of the world's population, it matters in terms of violence. So who you sign the contract with is not as important as who that person is, because the society is not actually going to be able to enforce those rules impersonally. It'll enforce those rules based upon the identity of the people involved in the arrangement. So today I want to sketch out an approach for understanding how society's become developed, what Charlie was talking about, you know, a conceptual framework for interpreting recorded human history, or at least the last 10,000 years of it. And to do so, we need to rethink some of our standard ideas about rules, about governments, about social dynamics, or at least what I want to say is that we need to rethink the standard way that economists think about them. And I know that I'm doing, you know, a bit of a disservice to everybody because I'm saying, well, here's what you're thinking. Well, yeah, of course, I don't know what you're thinking. So I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that when I go talk to people about this, that I'm confronted with a sort of standard way of thinking about what governments are and what rules are and how they work. And I think that is getting in the way of us understanding why impersonal rules emerge. In the kind of work that Charlie and I do in economic history, we really don't understand what happened in the United States between 1790 and 1840. We really don't. But we have an official view, which the bird of paradise crapped on the State House in Philadelphia in 1787. The Constitution was written, and boom, America happened. Well, we really don't know what happened. Then, you know, we can send birds of paradise around the world and they crap on state houses and nothing happens. So there's some important issues here that we have to rethink. So this is my cartoon version of the standard explanation. Social coordination is accomplished through rules. Rules exist at all levels of society, personal interactions, group interactions, organized activities in societies. Governments play a special role in creating and enforcing rules because the government's rules are public. They're rules that everybody knows. You know, there's lots of rules that we deal with that only apply to our lives, or only apply to the universities we work for, or only apply to the churches we go to. And they don't apply to other people. They just apply to the group that I'm involved in, the relationships. But governments are supposed to have public rules. Of course, treat everybody the same, right? To treat like. But they're really important because the coordinating power of government stated and enforced rules, created and enforced rules, has this enormous potential for increasing coordination within society. And typically we think of government's specific role as being unique because it has a comparative advantage in rule enforcement because of its comparative advantage in violence and coercion. And that's my co-author Doug North in 1981 talked about this in Structure and Change. But North is far from the only person who's talked about this. There's lots of people who identify the specific nature of what government does in its ability to enforce rules through coercion. As I've already said, impersonal rules are rules that treat everybody the same. More importantly, here, identity rules are rules that treat people differently according to their social identity. And identity rules are going to be really important in what I want to talk about today. Logically, governments can only enforce impersonal rules if they can potentially coerce everybody. The government has to be able to overawe people. That's the word that Hobbes uses over and over again in Leviathan. It must be a person to overawe. And he kind of waffles back and forth whether that's a person, the sovereign, or whether that's a sovereign legislature. But basically, he has one actor. In order to have credible law enforcement, the sovereign must be able to coerce everybody, even the powerful elites. So government monopoly on coercion is necessary for a modern society to evolve. This is Weber's notion of a modern state, is that a society with an organization that has a monopoly on the legitimate use of violence, or Charles Tilly's work, which is very important on coercion and capital in modern Europe. The idea that war makes states and states make war. So to understand how states actually got this ability to enforce impersonal rules and coordinate the way they do, we need to understand how they got this monopoly on violence. As I said, this is a simple version of the standard account, but it's a quick and easy way to summarize that the source of modern economic development certainly involves technology, resources, and that sort of stuff, but it doesn't happen in the presence of technology and resources unless governments are able to create and enforce impersonal rules. Rules that not only treat everybody the same, but by their very definition apply to the government as well. If they treat everybody the same, they apply to the people in the government just like they apply to people who are not in the government. As I said, this is a very simple shorthand. It's my motivating statement. So this is called Leviathan Denied. And if there's one takeaway you get from my talk this morning, it's that the ability of governments to create and enforce impersonal rules is not based on their coercive ability, but on their ability to coordinate. How many of you obey the rules in Savannah because you're worried the Savannah police force is going to come and put you in jail if you don't? Okay, now how many of those rules are ones that actually support modern economic development, like the contracts you write, the social arrangements you enter into, zero, right? Yeah, you might get thrown in jail because you're drunk, and you might get thrown in jail because you speed. But in fact, the really valuable relationships we have are not sustained by rules for which coercion is necessary to get them to enforce. In fact, what the rules are really doing is sustaining private coordination, what Dick Sitter-Greif might call private ordering. So we need to begin with that notion that somehow the rules we need to explain are not the rules that end up putting people in jail or coercion, but a way to sustain coordination. Logically, and this is where Hobbes kind of creates a problem for us, if governments are to enforce rules using coercion, then they have to organize violence, because the sovereign can't enforce the rules by himself, right? He's got to have these guys. He's got, you know. Now, he cannot enforce his organization that uses coercion by threatening to beat everybody in the organization up, because the organization has too many people who can beat the king up. And kings, of course, you know, they never rest soundly because their brothers and sisters and friends are going to kill them. So there must be something that organizes violence that's not just pure coercion. So we can't treat the government as a black box that has a monopoly on coercion. Because how the box is organized internally will affect how it behaves externally. So what I want to show, or try to show, is that the kind of rules the government can enforce is directly connected to the way that violence is organized, and vice versa, that the way violence is organized is tied to the way governments are organized. So there's a coordination problem not only in society, which governments help solve by providing public rules, there's a coordination problem for how do we get a government in the first place? How do we structure it? What is credible? What is believable in how the government operates? So we need to understand how governments are coordinated before we can grasp how modern societies emerge. Because clearly in modern societies, governments have a much bigger role and provide a much wider range of services than they do in developing societies, which have governments that we only need to look at the Middle East today to see the range of terribly functioning governments that are real choices, the real possibilities, because they exist in our world. There's nothing natural about the United States. So when I talk about rules, I'm going to go through this very quickly. We've already talked about identity and impersonal rules. They can be tricky to understand because rules both have a form and they have a method of enforcement. And when we say an impersonal rule treats everybody the same, we mean it treats everybody the same in its form and in terms of its enforcement. In most societies, how a rule is enforced depends on the identity of the people involved. If I get in a car accident, I live in Washington, D.C. If I get a car accident with a diplomat, it's my fault. It doesn't matter whether it was the diplomat's fault, because that's the way the rules are. The rules in Washington, D.C., actually throughout the world, diplomats are immune from prosecution, so they have a different set of rules that treats them differently. Much of the contest that's going on in the Middle East now is not about America and its role in the Middle East. It's about Shias, Sunnis and Shiites, different identities and different rules for how they will apply. So one dimension in which rules vary, therefore, is always this impersonal and identity rule dimension. And in some sense, in human societies, identity rules are the natural outcome. Impersonal rules are the odd one, because so few societies can actually do them. The second dimension, which I'm not going to play very much in my role in the talk I'm going to give today, but is very important, is the difference between boundary rules and default rules. Hayek in Law, Legislation, and Liberty talks about rules as boundaries. Rules set boundaries for what's right and wrong, what's allowed and disallowed. And of course, rules are enforced at the boundaries, right? And that's the one you're worried about going to jail about. You know, I crossed on the green light or the red light, or I went too fast, or I didn't pay my taxes, or something like that. And that's great, and in fact, Hayek has this very, very nice discussion about how rules create expectations about how other people are going to behave. So rules are very important because they evolve naturally, not necessarily government-imposed rules, they evolve naturally to order people's relationships so that we can have expectations about what we're going to do. And I think that's an incredibly important insight. And in fact, there's many legal theorists like H.L.A. Hart that have a similar kind of idea about expectations, and a tendency to treat rules as boundaries. But there are another set of rules which I'm going to call default rules, which is slightly different than the law and economics definition of what a default rule is. And a default rule set outside options for people. Okay. So I'm going to use an example which works for me because it's very personal. My wife and I have a lot of rules for specialization and division of labor within our household. One is I call the garbage rule, which is I take out the garbage. Actually, I'm a really good cook, but my wife does most of the cooking because she doesn't want me to eat things I want to cook. So what happens, though, is even though the rule is I take out the garbage, on a typical day, my wife takes out the garbage. And the reason is that when the garbage can gets this full, she gets bugged, and I don't get bugged until it's kind of coming out the top, or it's, you know, Monday night and the garbage is coming on Tuesday morning. So we have this rule, but it's not a boundary rule. If you observe our behavior, you would think, ah, the rule is Ellen takes out the garbage. That's my wife's name is Ellen. Not John takes out the garbage, or that there's some distribution of probabilistic outcomes, right? But the rule definitely is I take out the garbage, because if my wife says, will you take out the garbage? I say, yes. And it's one of those things that I don't say, you know, I'm writing this paper, I'll get to that tomorrow. I stop and I take the garbage out. Okay. The rule gives her an option. Asking me to take it out. This rule is completely enforced within our relationship. There's no third parties, there's no externalities. But the form of the rule is not that I take out the garbage, it's that my wife has an option to ask me to take out the garbage. Now, we all know we have lots of rules like this in our life. Many of you are at universities. And universities never follow the rules unless something breaks down. So you learn how to navigate your university, and when there was a problem, then maybe the rule will be applied. Because the rule is not actually what's coercing you. It's not bounding your relationship. The rule is there only if the deal with your department chairman falls through and you have to go to the dean and you have to recur to the rules. And of course, you can't go to the dean and say, the department chairman wasn't nice to me, because there's no rule about department chairman being nice. It's that the laws of the state of Maryland or the implicit contract at the University of Maryland says, hey, you're going to get paid X if you do Y. Okay. So the rules only act as a boundary when the outside option gets called. And so we'll define default rules here as rules, and I'll do this in a formal sentence in a minute, is that give parties to a relationship the ability to call on a third party to enforce the defaults. Now, my garbage example has no third party because it's sustained by the relationship between me and my wife. So a boundary rule and a default rule can have exactly the same form, John takes out the garbage, but they differ in their enforcement. So sometimes rules are written formally as defaults, but oftentimes they're written as boundaries, but then enforced as defaults. When we think about secure property rights and contract enforcement, the model we have in mind is often boundary rules. What are the rules you have to pay? Otherwise you'll go to jail or you'll be penalized or you'll be fined. The emergence of modern developed societies is, in my opinion, associated with a dramatic expansion of impersonal default rules. In fact, most of the rules that Charlie works on in banks and financial intermediaries and the growth of the financial sector is all about default rules. It's about how the court will interpret the contract if you have to go to court. God save us, we don't want to go to court. But going to court is an outside option. It gets a credible threat for both parties to enforce the contract they actually have, which is probably not the contract that's written down on the piece of paper that the court will actually enforce. That rules exist to make relationships more valuable, and default rules do that in a different way than boundary rules do. So if we conceive of rule enforcement as being enforcing the boundaries, then we're missing this whole world of default rules, which are not enforced at the boundary, or only at the very extreme case when the outside option is exercised. So, default rules give both parties the option of invoking the default rule by the third party. So where do credible third parties come from? And this is a really important problem, because you're going to have a rule enforcer, you got to have all the incentives lined up. It doesn't only have to be the incentives of the two parties to follow the contract, follow the agreement. The third party has to have the right incentives to enforce the agreement. Because if the third party doesn't have the right incentives, then the agreement is not ex ante credible. So we can't assume this problem away. You know, by defining the state as the organization with a comparative advantage in violence, or monopoly on legitimate use of violence, or organization with preponderance of violence, North, Weber, Tilly, the way we usually think about it. So how are third parties actually organized? And we give a verbal sort of model of this in Violence and Social Orders. I have some more formal kinds of ways of doing that. Basically, we say to lay out this logic is there's two kinds of organizations in the world. One are adherent organizations. Those are master roles and volunteer organizations, where everybody has an incentive to obey the rules and maintain the organization, or the organization breaks up. And contractual organizations are organizations that utilize third parties to enforce some or all of their internal arrangements and perhaps their external arrangements. So think about two groups of people, A and B, that are adherent organizations, they're volunteer organizations, they're hunter and gatherer groups, they're small groups. How do they form a bigger arrangement? And this is usually when I talk about this, I talk about violence and social order and coercion, which is clearly a problem, you know, if you're in Syria today. And so this is not an origin story. I'm not saying that deep 10,000 years ago in the past this happened. Think about how do A and B, how do some people from the two organizations commit to one another not to fight? To enter into an agreement that will in fact be credible when violence is involved. And basically the argument we suggest is that leaders or elites or the powerful organizations themselves make commitments to one another to essentially define and defend the property of the other leader. A makes a promise to B to define B's rights in the little B's, the land, labor, and capital in his group. And what that does is that gives A and B a wedge where they can credibly believe the other person won't fight. Because if B fights, so we can just divide the room. Charlie gets that half of the room, I get this half of the room. Charlie and I are trying to get an agreement. You know, Charlie just, he told me last night he was in Moscow and thought he could take 12 of the guys there. So how do I, if I enter into this agreement, how do I believe Charlie won't fight? Well, I know that if Charlie fights with me and violence breaks out, you guys are less productive. Charlie knows if violence breaks out, you guys are less productive, and I'm gonna suffer the loss of the rents that I get from you. And Charlie's going to suffer the loss of the rents that he gets from you guys. And that's going to give a wedge to make this relationship credible. That Charlie and I can actually coordinate it without using violence. So what happens is Charlie and I have an adherent organization. We have an agreement that's completely self-enforcing. There is no third party for us. But because we form this agreement, you guys become contractual organizations headed by Charlie and I. So I can write agreements with you. And if you try to beat me up, which clearly all of you could do, Charlie will come to my rescue, and vice versa. And our commitment to one another is credible because of what we're extracting from you guys. Now, this is a rent-creating mechanism. It's not rent-seeking, it's rent-creation, that enables the formation of larger, better groups and organizations. The natural state, we call this, creates rents from increased output and productivity through greater coordination and scale. And that's, in fact, part of the reason this arrangement is stable, is that if Charlie has a group A, Charlie gets rents, and those rents enable Charlie and I to enter into a credible arrangement, then I'm available to serve as a third party for Charlie and for you guys on this side of the room. And that means this organization is more productive. And those rents are also available to secure the relationship between Charlie and I, because if we stop coordinating, those rents go away. So this is a set of identity rules. Or I'll call this the AB world, or the natural state world. It's capable to explain the organization of violence in society, because in fact, Charlie and I now become the most violent people, not because we are endowed with a comparative advantage in violence, but because we are organized in a way that you are not. There's no government. Neither A or B, Charlie or I, don't have a monopoly on violence. There's no very Weberian state. Both of us use coercion. We threaten violence not only to you, but to each other. That's part of the credibleness of our arrangement. There is credible third-party arrangement enforcement of rules, but the rules of necessity are identity rules. It's important who Charlie and I actually are. I have got to know it's Charlie, and Charlie's got to know it's me. And when you guys come together to trade, we got to know whether you're an A or a B. And whether you're a Kalenjin or a Kikuyu if you're in Kenya, right? Whether you're a Sunni or Shiite if you're in Iraq. Whether you're a Catholic or Protestant if you're in 17th century Britain. We've got to know those identities in order to actually be able to make the rules credible. So, in no society, zero society, in the United States, no society, period, developed or undeveloped, can the government have a monopoly on the creation and enforcement of identity rules. Any two organizations that can create a credible arrangement can create identity rules that can coordinate people. This is one of the essential takeaways from Dixit's book on lawlessness and economics, or Abner Greif's notion of the community responsibility system. that if I can associate myself with an organization, the rents that I get from my organization enable me to credibly deal with other organizations with whom my organization has a relationship. But if that's the world you live in, you got to know which organizations you belong to. Are you a Protestant or you're Catholic? Do you go to this church or that church? You walk around Savannah. You go see all kinds of identities. I live in a big house. I own slaves. I grow cotton and I'm a Presbyterian. All those identities matter? Yeah, they really matter to how the rules are enforced. Okay, that's true even in an open access developed society with impersonal rules. Identities really matter. Organizations that form relationships, we can call them coalitions, and in a large society like A and B form a coalition, these coalitions of rule-enforcing organizations are grouped into networks. Call that the dominant network, if you will. So suppose we drop a government here. Bing! You know, my visual aids are really high-tech. Okay? In all societies, even the United States, governments are embedded in networks of elite organizations. Governments are just one kind of organizational node among many that govern relationships between elites and the larger society. Here, I'm not talking about elites as aristocratic inheritors of wealth and power. I am an elite. Charlie is elite. I suspect that most of you are elite. You're the economist for the Senate Finance Committee, right? I talk, people listen. That means I have influence. Am I the most powerful elite in the United States? No, we know that. I'm not even in the 1%. I'd love to be in the 5%. I'm struggling to stay in the 20% or somewhere. But I'm still an elite. Doug won the Nobel Prize. We go places and people say, I want to shake your hand. Presidents of countries say, I want to shake your hand. I said, Doug, you're an elite. And he said, no, I'm not. You know, because we think of ourselves as being just normal people, right? But in fact, what matters is not whether there's elites or not, because there's elites in every single society. What really matters is the dynamics between those elites. And governments are always embedded in networks of elite organizations. Organizations here are really the key, not that there's elite individuals, that there are organizations that are capable, through a logic that's perfectly explicable in economics, of forming long-term relationships that create value both for themselves and in relationship with other organizations. So we tend to focus on the internal capacity of government and not on the dynamics of the network. Yet, in fact, the capacity of the government to coordinate will be based as much on the dynamics of the network as it will be on the internal abilities of the government as an organization. So the government in that graph will not have a monopoly on violence and coercive power unless we give it to it by assumption. And then, of course, we've solved the problem of third-party enforcement of rules, because we've got one guy that can kick ass and take names on everybody else. Governments are usually only one organization capable of using coercion. Again, look around the world. The problem of coordinating what the government is extends beyond the government and includes coordination by all the powerful organizations in society. Arab Spring just brought this. What sprang up was not democracy. All of a sudden, all the powerful organizations that existed in those societies became apparent to outsiders because they started contending, some cases violently, for control of the society. The solution was not democracy and impersonal rules, despite people's wishful, good-intended wishes that that's what would happen. It hasn't happened anywhere. All societies until 200 years ago, like this thing about the barons in England, or the warlords in China, or the Timurats in the Ottoman Empire, all societies have powerful people who have to be kept in some kind of credible arrangements. Perhaps we can use the word balance if we want. But governments in those societies never are able to discipline anybody. They're only able to discipline some of their members if the other violence-wielding organizations are willing to coordinate with the government. The king can't kill anybody in England. He can only kill people if the barons agree to fight with him. So starting out with Leviathan, it's just going to mess us up. We're going to send weapons to places and think, we make one group stronger, we're going to establish law and order. And the answer to that is, no, we're not. Okay, so what do governments actually do? Identity rules are a solution to endemic violence in a natural state. And governments cannot have a monopoly on rule enforcement or violence and coercion in those societies. They can, however, play a central role in making information public about the agreements that powerful organizations have reached. In complicated societies, and most societies are really complicated, it's important to know what game, in game theory terms, what game are the elites playing? What are the powerful, what agreements do the powerful organizations actually think they've reached? Government organizations are organizations that signify public agreements. They stand up and say, here's what we've all agreed to play. And think about the inability to do that in Syria today, or what's happening with ISIS. People are announcing agreements every single day that are immediately the next day falling apart. And that's actually mostly the history of government agreements. They're able to get agreement on very little. But that doesn't mean there aren't some fundamental agreements that elites have come to see. And governments provide that coordination. So why impersonal rules? Well, the question we really have to answer is, why would these guys who are really powerful and are getting lots of rents, like Charlie and I, from our privileged position, why would we ever want to move to a system in which all of us, everybody in the room, is going to have exactly the same rule applied to it? Hobbes, Weber, Acemoglu, Robinson, many others argue that the coercive power of government that provides the incentive. That is, there's one organization that can coerce everybody, and as a result, that organization can enforce the same rules on everybody. But you can only make that argument if you ignore, well, where does the government come from? How did the government get this power in the first place? Why do people agree to this or not agree to this? In history, we know this doesn't work. Increasing the coercive power of the government organization leads to tyranny and slavery. It does not lead to impersonal rules. And we see this repeated over and over and over again. In fact, good governments in most societies, particularly in developing societies, are governments that actually enforce identity rules better, which causes an enormous problem for development policy, because we think identity rules are inherently corrupt. So a government that's trying to enforce identity rules better by making social identity stronger is likely to make some elites more elite, and we're going to say that's bad. If we think of government as a coordinator rather than a coercer, doesn't mean that governments don't coerce, because part of coordinating may be the threat of violence, that's coercion. Must be the case that the powerful organizations and elites want impersonal rules. That is, the dynamics of the network, the social dynamics of how power people interact, lead powerful people to want to have rules. And I know I'm doing okay. I got 5 minutes left. I figured I was probably running out of time by now. I'm going to give you a really simple example. And all of you are going to walk out of here saying, that was really stupid. That was obvious. You know, it's not obvious to you now what I'm going to do, but it will be obvious to you after I do it. But I want you to think about this example. This is totally different than the logic of Acemoglu and Robinson for why democracies arise, because elites get scared and give up their privileges and secure the giving up by democracy. This is a completely different story than that. This is a completely different story than Marx, where elites just exist to maximize their rents and they screw everybody else. And this is a completely different story than Tilly, where you have to organize coercive power in order to get a modern state. This says, why would elites want to have impersonal rules? And most importantly, why would powerful elites want to have impersonal rules, have a greater incentive to have impersonal rules than less powerful elites? Okay. Now, elites, of course, are highly differentiated by status. There is no elites versus masses in which all elites are homogeneously the same. It's like a Sherman-Rosen tournament. When you get near the top, the division and payoffs gets bigger and bigger. You know, so the king is really more powerful than the earls, who are really more powerful than the dukes, or more powerful than the counts. Or the sultan is more powerful than the caliphs, are more powerful than the timurats. Those status things really matter. So suppose two elites form a business. So I'm going to form a business with Charlie again, okay? Which is, I would lose the money, I know, because he told me at dinner. I know some family stories. I've been in Washington, D.C. But we're both going to put in time, resources, and money. But one partner does something that's more difficult for the other partner to observe. This is a typical theory of the firm problem, right? You can't contract on something you can't measure, so you can't get to a court to enforce it. So how can the active partner ensure that the passive partner will expend the agreed upon effort in the contract. Well, one solution would be for the active partner to give the passive partner a promissory note, say for $50,000. And the amount isn't important. It's just that the amount has to be larger than the cost of effort to the active partner. So the active partner wants to perform the effort. And the amount has to be smaller than the benefits of the ongoing relationship to the passive partner. So the passive partner wants to stay in the relationship and not cash in the check. This is just Grossman and Hart theory. You know, there's gazillions of models out there with this logic in it. So the arrangement is incentive compatible, and the expectation of both parties is that the note will never be enforced. So this is an outside option. The promissory note is creating within the relationship an outside option, just like the garbage example. But what happens if the elites are not equal? So to be realistic, Charlie's the more powerful elite, I'm the less powerful elite. Let's assume for simplification that the more powerful elite always wins when you go to court. Well, here's where identity rules work against elites. The more powerful Charlie is, the less able he is to bind himself through rules. So I think for purposes of illustration, I'm going to have 6 elites, 1 through 6. And in the following table, the column player writes the promissory note and the row player holds it. So the powerful elite can hold a note credibly, but he can't write one. Because I won't believe Charlie's commitment. If he gives me the note, I go to cash it in, he takes me to court and says, hey, you know, this is a fraudulent note. And the court says, oh yeah, you're Charlie Calamiris. He's John Wallace. You win. Okay? In fact, in most societies, we won't even go to court because I know I'm going to lose. I won't even enter into the contract. Right? It just won't happen. So here are the possible arrangements. I mean, I'm going to get rid of the diagonal. So there's 15 possible arrangements that can emerge in this society where the powerful elite can never write the promissory note. So what happens if we actually agree to treat everybody the same? That is to have courts that enforce the promissory note no matter who the parties are. And of course, this does not have to be every rule becomes impersonal. Just this rule, can we credibly enforce it? Now, if that happens, Charlie can now give me a promissory note, and I can credibly believe it will be enforced, and we're gliding over that credibility because we're trying to establish the incentives that Charlie and I have here. The matrix of contracts now doubles. So we're economists. That is specialization and division of labor. That is an increase in the extent of the market. That is economic growth. Interestingly enough, in the first column, I put ones down there. Those are all the new contracts that Charlie can now enter into that he could not enter into before. And there's 5 ones. A third of all the new arrangements that are sustainable accrue to Charlie, the most powerful elite. If I'm the least powerful elite, if I'm number 6, I get 0 out of this arrangement. I don't get any new arrangements because I was always weak. I'd get into these arrangements with everybody anyway. Now, as I said, this is a very simple example, but it's a very powerful example because it gives us the logic to begin to look in places in history and the way societies are organized where really powerful elites might have a significant amount to gain from enforcing the rules. I have a colleague, he's an assistant professor, he's coming up for tenure, so he's a little nervous, so he comes and talks to me a lot. I'm actually on his committee, and he's a Marxist, where he almost is. I don't know if he's completely out of the closet or not. He talks about Goldman Sachs and the mortgage-backed securities whenever I start talking about impersonal rules. He said, I don't have impersonal rules in America. And I said, well, tell me, would Goldman Sachs want to enforce the rules regarding mortgages? That is how you pay them. And would they want to have an impersonal rule for mortgages? And he says, yes. And I said, why? Well, because they're dealing in all these mortgages. And if they don't have impersonal rules for mortgages, then there won't be any secondary market for mortgages because you got to know who holds the mortgage. So Goldman Sachs is making billions off of these mortgages, and that creates an intense interest for Goldman Sachs to make sure there's an impersonal rule for mortgages. It doesn't mean that Goldman Sachs might not want to have too big to fail, which we're going to talk about later on in the conference, but it means on mortgages, the most powerful guys who are making the most money off the mortgages have the strongest interest in making sure that those rules are truly impersonal, because without impersonal rules, those kind of transferable financial instruments become much less valuable, and in fact, they become least valuable to the most powerful people in society. So the gains from moving to impersonal rules are probably asymmetric, and they benefit powerful individuals and organizations more than less. That's the social dynamic part. Now, if we're stuck in a world in which we think democracy benefits the people at the bottom and screws the people at the top, forget about getting to impersonal rules. Because the guys at the top are the ones holding the guns and holding the power, and they're going to say, no, we are not going to that arrangement. And we see it over and over and over and over and over again. All we got to do is take Syria, put it into civil war, and governments begin to spring up all around it. Powerful people who take advantage of organizations and create more chaos. So the ability to create and enforce impersonal rules is a central element in the emergence of modern societies. I've talked about different ways to think about it. I have three real conclusions for takeaways here. One is that rules can either be identity rules or impersonal rules, and we need to understand that the natural form of rules in most societies is not impersonal rules, it's identity rules. And that's consistent with the dynamics of how the system, how those societies work. Number two is that governments may possess coercive power, but essentially their ability to enforce rules depends upon coordination. It depends upon the value of the relationships that the rules apply to. That doesn't mean the government might not have to beat people up and put them in jail, particularly the speeders in Savannah. Okay. But it means that the coercive element is not the essential element of enforcing those default rules. And third, that social dynamics regulate in an adherent sense, in a self-enforcing sense, the use of violence and the relationships between powerful organizations. Those powerful organizations and elites all exist in the United States just like they exist in Syria or Turkey or South Sudan. In most societies, the best rules available are identity rules. They are the best rules sustainable because the rents created by the identity rules enable A-B relationships like Charlie and I had. That, of course, enables us to enslave you and all that kind of thing. But they're the best rules we got. In those societies, impersonal rules are not sustainable. And the World Bank can spend billions of dollars bribing those societies to adopt them, but they are not adopted because they are not sustainable. Impersonal rules are adopted when the coordinating benefits of government-enforced impersonal rules become large enough to powerful individuals and organizations. And that's what happens that moves societies towards modern economic development. Thanks.